I am a woman.
I am a woman.
I am a woman.
I am a woman.
I want to be successful.
I want financial support.
I want affordable health service.
I want to be powerful.
Powerful.
Supported.
Inspired.
Connected.
Educated.
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 I want specialized banking.
I want maternal care.
I want to be empowered.
I am a woman. I am a king woman.
I am a king woman.
I am a king woman.
I am a W woman.
That was my husband. And he says, you must come to Nigeria. You must come home. They don't know what you're doing over there. Your people must know what you're doing, who you are.
I was in a play at the National Theatre. I'd been with him before I left, and he was saying to me, you got to hurry up. Don't be late. You got to go there. But before I go, he was saying, if I knew then what I know now, I probably wouldn't go. He thought he was in the light. I said, are they filming us? I said, what do you mean, are they filming us? I got him, I gave him a pen, I got him to write, because I didn't think I understood him. I still have the paper. Are they filming us? I said, no, your bed is by the window, the sunlight. Well, that's what happens when you're going. The brain cells start giving sparks. So it's very good that he approached the light. He went with the light. I said, no, nobody is filming us. I think it's just the light, sunlight from your window. I left, I came back. When I came back, he was dead. I said, I left reception. Nobody was in reception, so nobody prepared me for what I was to see upstairs when I got to his room. I saw sheets over him. So I tell you, I've seen a great deal in my life. So I said, you've gone? So I said, well, I spoke to God. You're giving me everything. God, if this is what you think I should have now, I don't know what to make of this, but if this is what you think I should have, I accept it. But you have to sort me out, because I have no idea how I'm going to walk through this. This is me talking in the room with him. So I took a face towel, so I washed him down. I cut his hair, I cut his nails, and sat and waited for the doctor. The following day, I went to the theater and gave a performance. I think we had a couple of shows. I gave a performance because it was new. He died on the 31st of December, so New Year's Day. So we had a matinee and an evening show. At the end of the show, I then told them, Tom has gone. Nobody could believe it. You can hear the press. How can somebody die, somebody's husband die, and they're still working? According to what they knew. There can't be love, especially since, you know, it's Oyinbo now. There can't be love. What do they know about anything? I had all sorts of things. Who are they to know what my loss is? They're never going to know. They don't know him. They didn't know him. And they didn't know me. Just because you see me prancing around on stage doesn't mean you know me. You don't know who I am. You don't know anything about anything. So you say, it's not possible. It's impossible, of course. I don't recommend it to everybody, but that's how I face my life. I don't make my problem your problem. This has nothing to do with me. I take responsibility for my problem. If it's going to infringe on whatever you're doing, I'll do my best for it not to affect you. You know, I carry my own burden. I carry my own load. And I did. Love is not in the groin. Love is between your ears. Love is there. Love is service. Love is trust. Love is giving. It's not just taking. For those of you who just got married, love is looking after the other person. So he left his job and came home with me. And I mean no mean job. Everybody thought he was mad. That's love. So of course, it will be there 50 years. As long as I live, I'll remember him. Because he wasn't just my husband. And it's not the usual, he's my friend, no. He's a man of vision. He's a great man. He's a man with a great mind. No day goes without me thinking about my husband and Kendi. You know, I still think about her. I think love, you can't dilute love. Whether somebody likes you or they don't like you. This blood is thicker than water, as they say. She was my sister. You know, I still think about her. I still miss her. I still wish she had lived. You know, I don't like the way she died. In fact, when she called me the day she died, the day before she died, she called me and said, from Germany, from hospital, and said, "Oh, Taiwo, things are not so good. She was in hospital, and." You know, she told me her lungs keep taking water and they keep taking it out and I think she said something like this might be goodbye, and I said, "Oh, don't say that, I'm coming." So I rushed trying to get, I didn't have a visa to Germany. I don't think they had a e-passport then. So I, in the middle of trying to get to my MP to try and help me get to the embassy, I called the embassy, German embassy in London. I live in Newmarket. I live away from London. To get the local MP to help me expedite a visa that I must go to her. She died. Death, don't think about it. It doesn't scare me. You don't know about it when you're dead, darling. So what is there to be afraid of? Is that this vile world, if I'm taking from it, what exactly is here that I'm going to miss so much? It's another world. Did it scare me before I was born? I didn't know anything about it. But I know about here now. And therefore, I study and live on mindfulness about now. Insightfulness of what happens at the moment. At some point I will die. I will be ill, or may not even be ill. Something will not work, and it will be time to go. I'm not worried. I'm more concerned about what I'm doing now, to make sure I do what I'm doing now well, to enjoy what I'm doing well, to be mindful of the now, that this very moment, because this won't repeat itself. I will never have now. And the now that I have is what is preparing the future. So this is the only gift I have, sitting here. So why am I going to worry myself about dying? That I don't know when it's coming or how it's coming and where I'm going? No. The racism business is a political game. The superiority complex of an insecure race, that's all. The white race is afraid of the black race. Unfortunately, we haven't questioned why they are scared of us. We got rhythm. I know politically somebody will say that's not, they think we can all dance. Yes, it's important to be able to dance.
It's important to be able to be poetical. The poetry we write with our bodies is enviable. Where the only people think we should be stealing something from them, we should be borrowing, we should be emulating them, they're getting here, coming here, wholesale and exporting our stuff and repackaging. My mother was an Amazon. You just call her an Amazon. Huge woman. Yeah, huge, black and beautiful. In England, when they asked me what my mother was like, I said she was ivory. I loved that color. She was Adumadon, is what Yorubas call it. Black and shiny. You got to be your authentic self. And I'm not afraid or ashamed of who I am. I think black is beautiful. I think I'm beautiful. I think I'm good looking. You see what I mean? Not in a superficial. Look at the bones God gave us. Look at the shape God made for us. Look at this. He's balanced this with this, with this, with that, and everything. I don't have any intention of messing with what the perfection is already made. So I'm not worried about how I looked. And it's not even about physical beauty. It's about a political statement. It's about not somebody not making me into their image. Above all else, know that the Lord God made us the way we are and everything about us in perfection. It won't take anything from that. You can't add to the perfection. I never had any problem with racism. What it taught me, and it still teaches me, is that good is good and bad is bad. And that there's nobody can take good, do anything to you if you're good. And that you can be confident if you're good, you don't need anybody's approval. That's the passport for wherever it is you want to go. You don't have to say, look at me, 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 aren't I pretty? You don't have to. You can look like, your face can look like the back of a bus. People would want to know you because it's what you're selling that attracts them. It's your mind that attracts them because it's the mind that informs everything we do. That's the engine. The signal we're sending to the world is that for some reason we are a little bit we don't like our hair the way it is. Well, even the white people, some of them don't like their hair. It's too lank, it's too curly, but our own is not like that. We actually change it to theirs. It's almost like self-loathing. I don't like something about, so I don't like my nose too flat, so I got to go and change it, or whatever it is, so that is the thin line, whatever, is the one, is the, Europe generally, or the West, dictate our tastes. I've always objected to that. So in Europe, when I went to England, I constantly did my hair as we did it here, to go over there. And I remember in the underground, people used to get up from my side because I looked too bush, but it's now become a fashion. Well, I wore it in England. It wasn't even an aggressive statement. That was just me in England. And I would wear my hair like that. I cut it, I sit in front of the mirror, and then braided it myself. I did my hair, and I had long hair then. Under here, I have my hair. I still keep my hair. There's no way politically I think it's okay for me to. I'm in tinsel right now. And they started out wearing wigs for me and I said no. Because if I'm on television and and people are watching, make a statement about who you are. I don't intend to please anybody if they think I'm not easy on the eye. Because I haven't got a conventional look. That's not my job, to make anything easy for anybody, if you see what, in that sense. But it's my job to be authentic. Every stage of my life, I've accepted as it comes. I wouldn't change anything about my life. I wouldn't change aging. And it's not because, as they say, I'm aging gracefully. No, I think everything that life gives to you, you should use. We all know we're going to die. Therefore, while you're aging, you should live. That's all I do. That's how I feel about aging. I'm 75 now. I don't feel 75. So, it's another day. It's a journey, and I'm going on. And as long as I have good health, the only thing about aging, of course, you know, all your assets are diminishing bit by bit. But that's what it's all about. If you lose enthusiasm for life, you're going to lose energy. There's so much outside there that's not edifying, that doesn't encourage you to keep going. But it's going on out there. What's going on in here for you? It's all about your own consciousness of what's happening. It's how you perceive the world. If you're aging and you say, yes, this is my age, I'm supposed to do this, I'm not supposed to do that, then you know, you're never going to get out of bed. But if you carry on doing what you're doing, if you carry on giving, you'll be getting. If you give strength, you will get strength. Women have been sexualized, objectified, and we have bought the sale of goods, the bill of goods, a bill of sales. We bought it, that we have to look certain way, that our shape's got to be like this. You know that your metabolism will slow down. Knowledge again about your physiology, about your physiognomy. Knowledge. You know that this is how it's done. You enjoy yourself at every stage. But if you're worrying yourself that, you know, my stomach is not as flat as it was before. Are you sitting there looking at my stomach? No. Exactly. Everything is in the eye, not even the face. Everything. The eyes are the window to the soul. But people think they're looking at them, say, oh, look at that, look at that. Those who are doing that, they're idle. Even the man who falls in love with you would not know what he fell in love with. It won't be that. It will be your aura he fell for. It will be a smell from you that you don't even know you have. It will be your soul that claims him. It won't be how big your breasts are. When it's like that, then he's talking about something different. When somebody says, you used to be like this, you are not like this. I say, I'm 74, 73 or whatever. If it's worrying that person that I'm not 8 stone or whatever, what kind of mind is that? Okay, so is the person who thinks you should be worrying about your body. You shouldn't worry about your body. The responsibility you owe your body is for it to be fit. You keep your body in tune all the time. Because even the Bible says, know ye not that ye are the temple of the living God? You're housing God inside you. You are the temple. And for that reason, you must take care of your body. Not to flaunt it about, it means look after it, so that the mind can function better. The unity of the body and mind is what you must always be concerned with. Spirituality is what I think a great deal of. I don't have time for organized religion. It enslaves minds. It just, instead of delivering to people the real message, in the books, in the religious books, it has bastardized the messages. It is exploiting the ignorance of the people. It's about fellowship and it's about enlightening one another. But it has become for those who lead, for them to think, to be even holier than God himself, to make themselves God on earth. And the Bible says that he is the only one and that you mustn't worship anything. You go to most churches, it's our pastor. My pastor said this. My pastor is this. They deify him. They worship him. If he doesn't have service that Sunday, they're not going to go to church. So who are we going to church for? So the pastor is now leading these people who are looking up to him like this. Dunderheads who don't want to think for themselves. Don't keep saying, oh, I want to go to Hollywood. I want to be this. I want to do that. And you don't get off your bed, though. You don't get off your backside. And you want to be the prime minister. You want to be the president of Nigeria. You don't get yourself educated. You don't go and work into some professions so that you can make some contribution. But you want, you don't give. You ain't gonna get it. So it doesn't matter how much faith you have about you making it in the future. You don't put one foot in front of the other. You ain't gonna get there. You think, oh, your father is this, that, and the other. Oh, he's bound to do it. He's bound to do it. No. You don't make the move. Your father can't push you. So people go to church and sit down and be screaming God. He's not left where he was. He's giving you all the opportunity. What have you done with it? You have a voice in your head. The day you stop listening to it, it will abandon you. I never knew what it meant then. But I knew that, my mother said we should be listening to our voice. And I listened to it. So my instincts now is so perfected. I'm still working on it, but it's so accurate that if I say I'll do this show, I don't know why I'm doing it, and there may be all sorts of odds stacked against it, I'll do it. Because God knows what is going to turn out, and it always turns out okay. So I never question anything. I go with my instincts. Never second guess the God in you, because it is the God in you. Oh, we have the devil talking to us as well. That's the one saying, how can you go and do that? He asked you to come and do that. Oh, since I know that you are very busy, and who is you to be calling me to come and do this? That kind of thing. If I go and do that now, there's going to be a traffic jam. And all those things that make us think that we're making sense. A lot of us, that's what we listen to. That's the devil in us. The bit that says, go for it, girl. Without any reason, go for it. The odds are stacked against it, and you say you are going for it. Somebody will say, are you mad? You're going to go and do that. Don't you know? Don't you know? Don't you know? Don't. Knowledge is of the essence. You have a baby. It's crawling. It must learn to crawl. Of course, it wants to run to that place. It can't do that. It must learn to crawl. First of all, it must learn to sit down. Eventually, it sits upright. It has to learn to balance, to get the balance. It's about, as I said, the universal law. Then it must crawl. Then it starts holding things and it starts walking. They'll fall down and get up. Eventually, it can start running. Which one of those things do you think that child can just fly over? Exceptional children, perhaps. One in 1,000. But you have to go through that. And when that child perfects the art of working, of walking, they're running. Why do we want to think that we can just get there, not by learning? Simply because if you want to have shortcuts, you're going to be falling down a lot. A child that doesn't want to crawl, that doesn't want to crawl before it walks, is falling down all the time. Will be falling down all the time.
And the tragedy of our life, and I've said it before, the greatest evil that we have in the world is ignorance. If you don't do this, this is what will happen to you. If you don't do this, this is going to happen to you. If you don't do this, this is what. So, choose well. That's God. He's not going to come down from heaven to force you to do what you should do. He says to you, you should do it this way. You know you should do it this way. And you can do it that way. I give you a choice. It's a very respectful God. Very, very courteous God. He doesn't push you around. He's not an enslaver. He respects your intelligence. He is intelligent. So, he says, well, this is it. And you have that, and you decide you are going to choose this. And then you're screaming and say, why aren't you doing something about this trouble, this hole I dug for myself? He's already told you there's a hole there. He says, do this. So Moses says there, choose life. In other words, choose carefully.
Mrs. Taiwo Ajai-Lycett is such a force of nature. Every syllable she speaks packs so much energy with it. Every story that she tells has a lesson to it. And the lesson I learned from this episode is, no matter how bad your circumstance is, you can always dig yourself not only to the surface, but also to the top of the mountain. Thank you for watching.
What you didn't ask me is, why didn't I get married? You tell me, who do I want to marry after that? If you've had caviar, who needs fish? Thank you.